person, and she wanted breast implants. And she's like, after this lecture, she's like, do you think I should get breast implants? I'm like, well, first of all, no, but you don't need that, but that makes you feel better. And then come to find out she had a patient, I mean, her family history, her mom, her grandma, her aunt had breast cancer. And I'm like, why would you want a breast implant that could possibly hide the, you know, and the chances of you having breast cancer are greatly increased. She got them anyway, so I guess she was okay. But, you know, I didn't understand that. But anyway, it wasn't me. So breast implants, that comes to mind every time. And then, of course, pregnancy or nursing, certainly several reasons. Breasts swell up when pregnant, and that would be very painful with the compression, and then, of course, radiation exposure. So unless there is, when do pregnant women get radiated? Never, hopefully, but only if it's an emergency. And unless there's something terribly wrong going on, we wouldn't want to do that unless we, you know, had to. So usually there's not breast emergency situations that can't wait. A lot of times if a doctor does see something on a mammogram, what do they recommend?
Biopsy.
They could do a biopsy.
Ultrasound.
Ultrasound, they can do an ultrasound of it. Or follow-up in 6 months. A lot of times they may request a follow-up to see if it's changed, grown, or not. That would be hard for me. I would be a mess, you know. But a lot of times that's the cautionary way. Breast biopsies are not easy. I hope you have the opportunity, ladies, to observe one, but that's putting the needle into the tumor at the tumor site. So a lot of times it is MRI-guided or ultrasound-guided needle biopsy. And hopefully they get into that tumor first stick. Doesn't always happen. The X-ray machine, this is, of course, it's an X-ray tube, but it's going to be a little bit different than of what we use in the radiology department. For instance, the first thing, I'm sorry, that cut off right there, that's target. Molybdenum or rhodium is the primary target material. What is our target material in regular radiography routine?
Tungsten.
Tungsten. Wow, that should have just been thrown out of your mouth. Tungsten. Okay, but in mammography. Okay, so do you know what KB range we use in mammography?
No. Low KB.
It's right here. 25. Would that penetrate a hand?
No.
No, absolutely not. We need about 45 or 50. But what is breast tissue? It's just tissue. So what we use is really low energy X-rays. Okay, so tungsten will produce those, but it produces most, you know, above that amount. So we want a target material that will produce primarily low energy X-ray photons. Molybdenum and rhodium have a lower atomic number than tungsten does. Okay. So that's different.
They still use, why do we use grids if it's such low KV and such low mass?
Because of scatter.
Even though there's no bone in there? Or?
Right, but breast tissue is still tissue and tissue will scatter. So that's what I'm trying to, and I'm glad you brought that up. They want that, with mammograms, we need exquisite detail. So any scatter is going to obscure detail, any scatter. So we use a grid to clean it up. It could be a low ratio grid, but still a grid. Anode heel effect, the base of the breast, which is the closest to the chest wall, is thicker than towards the nipple area. So anode heel effect is used. So we do have AEC cells, and I'll show those to you. We pick the one through the thickest area. Short exposure time, short. Again, for all the reasons. Now, the breast tissue is compressed. That's part of the reason it's compressed, to hold it still. And have the patient hold their breath to hold them still. And then short exposure times, right? So that we don't capture any motion whatsoever. And then, of course, the most important part of all this is the compression. So there is a compression paddle, which I'll show you. Focal spot sizes, again, for better detail. Now, for regular radiography, it's usually 1 to 2 millimeters, maybe 0.6, 2.9. in your regular x-ray tubes. Look at the focal spot size here. Do you know, remember the name that we call any tubes that have 0.3 millimeter or less?
Macro radiography?
Micro tubes or...
macro radiography?
Fractional, yes. Micro, well, macro is larger, and we do some of that in breast imaging. But fractional focus tubes. So we want these x-ray tubes for mammography, specifically for mammography, to have as low focal spot size as possible. And then they also have two sizes just like we do. So almost the same, but a little bit a difference. Now, here is a dedicated mammography machine. This is the image receptor. There's the compression paddle right there, and you can see the where it can be raised and lowered there. The x-ray tube is up here. X-ray tube is a fixed distance that's not going to change. It's usually stuck at 36 inches, a little bit less than 40 inches. So again, just some other images. Here is, with digital radiography, there's the detector here, compression paddle again. Usually, the tech, if you've ever had a mammogram, it's all in the same room. The tech does not step outside the room. They usually stand right behind a leaded glass barrier. So they're able to look at the patient and step quickly away. Okay? So they're not going out the door and around the corner looking through a window at you like we do with regular radiography. Okay? So they're literally right there, which is important with the compression, and I'll tell you that. So there is a cone. This is the cone right here. You see that the cones are usually round. This one is a flat cone on one side for obvious reasons. So it's flat here against the chest wall. And then here is the image receptor. There's the compression. You're gonna see this throughout these slides. So one thing I want you to pay attention to is that compression starts up here. Remember, the breast tissue goes up, and so we wanna pull all that breast tissue down and out onto the image receptor. So it's not just here. We start up here with the compression. And that is automated. So compression, the way we used to do it, it was a hand crank. So over here on the side, we would bring it down and then crank it for tightness. So with one hand, how awkward is that? One hand has the breast tissue. Imagine this. I'm going to try to do this without touching myself. Imagine this, breast tissue being brought out onto an image receptor, right? What happens at me as a tech and I let go of that breast tissue? It goes right back to the chest wall. It's flexible. Okay, elastic.
Elasticity.
Elastic. That's what I mean.
They go back.
Okay. So it rebounds back to the chest wall. So the tech has to have at least one hand on the breast tissue and then cranking down that compression paddle until it's where they want it to be, and then they can let go. Okay? Wouldn't it be better to have two hands on the breast, and so now they have a foot pedal that they can do for compression? Okay, and then, so the compression comes down, both hands are on the breast tissue, bringing it forward until the compression paddle is at the proper place and compression, and then they can bring their hands out, okay? And I'm getting to the compression part. So you can see she has her gown on, only one breast is exposed. So to see this breast tissue, the patient turns a little bit. So we've got one side, and then we do both breasts for all of our mammograms. We don't just do one. So functions of compression. Okay, so here's breast tissue that is not compressed. We see some microcalcifications and a nasty looking tumor there. And so with compression, a layperson would not understand this. But why is this better than imaging like that?
No OID?
Yeah, look at the decreased OID, right? Isn't that better for detail? Decreased OID, so that brings these two areas of concern closer to the image receptor. Also, here's a thickness of the breast here. That means more radiation versus less radiation, correct? I think those two things, if you told a female patient coming in who was nervous about the compression, and you said, let me tell you what compression does for you, for your image, they would go, oh, I can handle a couple of seconds of being uncomfortable. So this is what I want you to take away from this, gentlemen. So I want you to really pay attention to this. And ladies, too, for you know, our friends, our female friends and loved ones, how important this is. So here is the compression. Now look at the compression paddle. I'm going to show you some other images. That compression paddle, it needs to compress up to 25 to 45 pounds of force. How do they know that? They get a weight, a scale, a bathroom scale, put it on there and compress. That's one of the QAs, is to make their quality control to make sure it's compressing enough. Usually there's a digital readout. I've talked to mammography techs, and they like a certain amount. Can they use that amount on everybody? No, they make adjustments. But I mean, my tech was like, well, I really like to try to get to 35 if I can. You know, so they kind of have an experienced tech will kind of have a number that they want to use. Do we want to hurt the patient? No, but the better compression we get, the better the image will be. So certainly, if a patient starts to complain or anything, then that would be stopped. Okay, so decreased dose. I think that alone, a female would not be so scared of compression. It helps. You get less radiation. Wouldn't anybody like that? Decreased scatter. So decreased scatter meaning better detail. The compression holds the breast tissue out onto the image receptor and holds it still. We have increased contrast, which a layperson wouldn't understand that so much. Okay, you have over and underlying structures, right? What happens, okay, just like our, when do we use a compression in radiography? You've all been involved with
small bowel.
Small bowel, right? So that compression over the terminal ileum, what is it doing? It's spreading out the loops of bowel so that we can see in between and see that terminal ileum to make sure, right? Okay, same thing with breast tissue. Those over and underlying structures are now spread out to where you saw the dense breast tissue. Who could tell what was in that? So we're going to look at some, and you're going to see where we get really good compression, and you can see in between those structures that may be superimposed. Lots of reasons. You know, 1 minute of explaining that to a patient or to a friend would alleviate that concern, I think. No compression. Okay, this is what happened with the MQSA. This is, what is that? Mammography Standards Quality Control Act. Okay, they got really strict on the compression. And this is what we used to do. I would have been very proud of that. This is what we're doing today. Look at the difference. What does that mean? We're compressing better and getting more breast tissue. Okay, mom, the reason you're not getting a mammogram, let me just show you, you know, here's this one. Here's what compression does. Oh, okay, well, if I'm going to have one done, we might as well see all the breast tissue, right? So it's very important. Again, here's what we did before. That's fine. I see the denseness. Is that a tumor or is that a tumor? I don't know. Not my call. Look at with better compression. Do you see that cystic area? Look at it right there. We can see it better. So the compression is extremely important. We do have magnification. So because the X-ray tube has a fixed SID, we have to bring the breast tissue up closer to the tube. Instead of bringing the tube closer to the breast tissue. And so we have a magnification platform that sits over the image receptor, and then there's your compression paddle. So this part would be lowered, the breast tissue placed on that, compressed, and then, so that's what causes our magnification. We want it magnified, but we've got to offset the loss of detail, right? What happens when we use magnification? We lose detail. So how do we offset that? And that's by using those small focal spot sizes. So instead of using 0.3, we can go down to 0.1, which is extremely small. So we talked about if low KV is used, we use high mass. Look at this 800 to 900 millirad of exposure. That's almost one rad with a 1.3 to 1.5 rad glandular dose. It says repeat rate less than 5. The number one reason that we had a repeat for mammogram again was our technical factors, getting it too dark or too light. With digital, that has gone away. So your number one reason for a repeat now would be positioning and not having all the breast tissue on there, not seeing what needs to be seen. So because we are using lower KV is not as penetrating. Our patient exposure is a concern, so reducing repeats always helps. You talked about this a little bit earlier. What are some alternative methods, some other imaging modalities that we can use? Sonography is a good one. We don't do, there are, I'm not going to say pediatric, but young females who develop breast cancer. I had a girlfriend who, she had it when she was like 25, and they had to do a mastectomy, they did a mastectomy way back when. If a tumor was found, the whole breast tissue was taken. Now they're better at taking the tumor, only the tumor. They call it a lumpectomy and able to save the breast tissue. Not all the time, but a lot better. I mean, before tumor, breast went down to the chest wall. It's not like that as much anymore. So what do you do for these women who are 20, 25, 30, and they're within childbearing years and radiating breast tissue at a young age? So a lot of times, if they felt a lump, they would do a sonogram first, just to see, is it cystic, is it fluid filled, or is it solid? Does it have smooth borders or spiculated borders? So they could kind of get an idea before they did try not to have a mammogram done. But as an older female with a mammogram and they think they see something, they can do an ultrasound on it just as a follow-up for that little for that area. Nuclear medicine is, although I have it second up there, this is not in any particular order. I would say this would be way down low as far as of the other imaging modalities. You might do, if you're doing nuclear medicine, looking at breast is typically to see metastasis. Breast tissue tends to metastasize to the bone. Not all the time, but typically. And so we'll do a bone scan, nuclear medicine bone scan, to see if it's metastasized or not. Sometimes it can be done for the nodes. The lymph nodes are also affected. So a lot of times when they do a mastectomy, they'll take the breast tissue and there's a lot of lymph nodes in the armpit area, the axillary area, and they'll take a few of them to see if the cancer is spread to any of those lymph nodes. Once it hits the lymph system, it can go throughout the body. So it's important to survey those to make sure that the cancer hasn't spread to that. So maybe a nuclear medicine scan for that. PET imaging, typically not. MRI, yes. This would be, this is the area I would like to see grow. This is where I think your future is going to be, things changing in radiography. I think MRI has a future. I just hope we can get it there. MRI is not using radiation. They are doing quite a few MRI-guided biopsies and imaging to follow up with mammograms. Radiography mammograms are still the gold standard, okay? However, MRI can be used. The problem with MRI, as it is with anything, it's expensive, it's slow, and the problem is it can give high false positives. What does that mean?
False diagnosis.
Right, it's saying the patient has something when they don't. That can be almost as bad as, the opposite. So anyway, what happens with a false positive? You don't really have cancer, but the doctor thinks you do, so you get a biopsy or you get another exam. You don't sleep, you worry yourself sick, your family's freaking out. So it causes a lot of problems. And expense. Digital breast tomosynthesis. This is a new thing, and I have 3D breast imaging. This is awesome, and I have a video. In fact, I'll show it to you here in just a minute. They're doing 3D imaging of the breast tissue. This is tomo, meaning a cut. So your hat. It's a the breast tissue is just like it was before. It is compressed, just like a regular mammogram, but the x-ray tube makes a sweep. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'll show you a picture of that. Here's sonography. So anything fluid-filled is a cyst, so that's what we want to see. You may see that on a mammogram, but you may not see these two other structures that are right behind it, which that looks like another separate cyst, and that looks like more tumor-like. So you can see the smooth borders here of this tumor. So those are, Let me tell you, ultrasound of the breast tissue is very difficult. If you have, you need the experience. Everything kind of looks like that. That's real hard to see. They did a really good job. You don't see all the borders. You just see that border and that one. That's shadowing. Anyway, here's MRI. These are probably not the best images, but this is film screen mammography. So this is a regular mammogram, and you can see what MRI does. You cannot see. You see the tumor right there? Mm-hmm. Right there? You cannot possibly see that in a mammogram, even if it were a better image of that. So MRI is good at looking through all of that and making sure, seeing underlying hidden structures. Why is mammography done? Of course, for any possible carcinoma, cysts, fibrocystic changes. Do you know what gynecomastia is?
And that's growth tissue in guys.
Uh-huh, growth, breast tissue growth in men. And then again, this is another ductal cancer. So here are the different positioning methods that we use for mammogram. However, typically we just have a routine. We have a routine for mammogram, and it's CC and the MLO, these first two. So CC stands for craniocaudal. One of the things that the MQSA dictated is that you have to put down on the image what the position is. So you would have your right marker with your initial and then the letters CC for craniocaudal, MLO for mediolateral. It's kind of what we're doing now, right now with Right Digital. I mean, are we not imprinting what the is, what we're doing on the computer? So they do have to be labeled. So these are the routine, and I will ask you that on your test, which are the routine. We're going to look at that. I want you to be able to recognize one from the other. A true lateral, exaggerated CC, the XCCL. I'll show you these each. The ID image, implant displacement from below. I'll show you that. That's the opposite of a CC. So cranial caudal, right?
This
cancer
way, right?
Tube is going from head to feet. Okay. Well, what you can turn, like a C-arm, you can turn that X-ray, the mammography tube, opposite, where the X-ray tube is below and the image receptor is on top. What do you do with a kyphotic older female? Here, they're coming in like this, right? And you want to do a mammogram? That breast, let me tell you, it's like this. Your head's going back, your chest is going forward, you're turned, your arm has to be a certain way, head out of the way. Can you imagine a kyphotic female? They can't pull back, and so the clavicle is going to actually be in the breast tissue. So they turn the tube upside down and can go caudal, cranial, but that's still a CC. So if you put CC, we're expecting it to be from this direction, superior, inferior. So they call it FB, the X-ray coming from below. With cleavage view, interesting, huh? And then the axillary tail. So let's go through these real quick. So this is a cranial caudad. So again, we don't care about the other breast tissue. The patient is turned slightly, as I said before, turned slightly. Look at the tautness of that. They really captured this upper breast tissue and pulled everything out. Breast tissue, the nipple is in profile. We want this fold. The breast has to be lifted up and out, okay? And then compression. My question to you, which AEC cell is selected?
Center.
It's going to be the one closest to the chest wall. Okay. That's the other thing that the compression does, and I think, I don't know if I said it on the slide or not, but it evens out. Remember, the breast tissue is thicker towards the chest wall. In the nipple area, it is thinner. So this helps even out the thickness of the breast tissue from the back to the front. And so here, we look at them a lot of times like this. It's up to the radiologist. But this is the CC, the right and the left. And we do it for comparison purposes. So a lot of times, if you get pretty good compression on the right and the left doesn't look the same, the radiologist is looking at that. Is this compression the same as that one? And if it's not, then it needs to be a repeat. So you really need to make sure your images look the same. And let me tell you, breast tissue mirrors the other breast. So that's the other thing the doctor is looking for. Do you see this area and that area? The fact that it is on both sides is another indication that the breast tissue is probably normal. If you saw this here and did not see that over there, that would be a concern. Okay, so the breast tissue does mirror each other. I see something here. I don't know if that's something or not. Is that something or not? I see those two things that I don't see over here. I don't know. I'm not the doctor. Do you see this bright area here? This does not always show up. However, this is the goal, and that is
the muscle,
the wall muscle, the chest muscle, the pectoral muscle, excuse me, the pectoral muscle. So you know that this tech got all the way back as far as possible. It's not a criteria. It's just a desirable one, something that we want to see. So this is the CC view. Let's look at, this is the MLO. This is the other one. Now, this is where, okay, the image receptor is not here anymore. It's brought up to the side. So it's coming in to the side area. The arm is relaxed. You can imagine if the arm is brought up, what does that do to the breast tissue? It pulls it out of the way of the image receptor. So this area right here is not seen on the CC. Yes?
Do we do multiple views for?
Two. For a screening mammogram, we do two. The CC, which is like your AP in a way, right? And then your kind of your lat. It's not a true lateral, but
it's an oblique.
So the image receptor is here, and the X-ray tube is here, so it's coming in from this direction, okay, as opposed to a true lateral. And so, again, this is that inframammary fold. The breast tissue, again, needs to be brought up and out. So we're holding on to this while the compression's coming down, and the tech slides their hand out as this is coming down. They're operating this compression with their feet. Now, let me tell you, I forgot to tell you about this. So there was a study done. There was a study done, and the patients were given the foot pedal to compress their breast. And they were educated about the importance of compression, just like I educated you. And it was found that they compressed more than what the techs would have. Probably because a couple reasons. They knew how important it was, and second is because they had control. Just the fact when you have your own control, then you have a little bit more tolerance. So the other thing to explain to your friends, family, and loved ones is to, so the breast is compressed, the patient's in this position, and compression, and the tech says hold still. Now the tech is right here. Okay, so compress, okay, hold still, beep, and then you know what happens before they even come out from around their shield? The compression automatically starts releasing. So that you don't even have to wait for the tech to come over and release it. And it's a gentle release, so it starts immediately. It doesn't just like that, because that can make the breast tissue rebound and cause some discomfort. So it's a not slow, but gentle, a gentle release. So just let your loved ones know it's only for, the last thing they do is compress. First thing that happens after the exposure is decompress, I guess. So that's important. So the MLO is going to get more of this axillary tail area. Okay, you see the difference here? That has to be on the image. The axillary tail should be seen all the way down to the level of the nipple. Now, the nipple is a lot of times overexposed, obviously, because this is a thinner part. But with visual, you'd be able to see that. So they did much better on this one. They were a little bit better on this one than they did on that one. That's a calcified duct. That happens as women get older. Breast tissue changes from glandular to fatty or adipose, which is why they get saggier. Those connective tissue, the Cooper ligaments, become more relaxed. And then you're looking at that inframammary fold being open down here. So this is the ML. Look at this right up here. This is what I'm talking about. That axillary tail now is seen on the image where it wasn't on the CC. So again, things can be hiding up there. Here is a true lateral X-ray tube. On this side, the image receptor is in between the breasts. That's a true lateral. You're going to miss some of that axillary tail. Again, the breast tissue needs to be brought up and out. You know what that is? Do you ever see that at your hospital?
Smelling salts.
This right here. Yeah, smelling salts. It's ammonia. It's an ammonia capsule. So if they felt faint. Have you ever smelled one of those? Do you have those in your departments? Sometimes they will be taped to the collimator of your x-ray tube someplace. Just like this one is this tape. Now this is a mammography tube, but if someone were to faint, you could break one of those open and don't put it right under their nose. If you ever had the opportunity to smell, it's ammonia. Have you ever smelled straight ammonia? If you're passed out, it will bring you to. Let me tell you, that's the bad stuff.